to wipe the slate, and Affable go on. Down at the rail, Barraza is back to third. There's an eighth of a mile to run. Wipe the slate just in front of Affable. Wipe the slate 3/4 of a length. Affable trying hard along the inside, but Wipe the slate doing the better work past the 16th, and it will be Wipe the slate and Mario Gutierrez to win comfortably by about 2.5. Affable second, deservedly third.
Welcome back to Racing Rundown here on YouTube. I'm Eric DeCoster, and if you were wondering if Derby prep season was getting underway at any time soon, it starts this weekend because we have some excellent Derby point races scheduled for this upcoming Saturday. The Bob Lewis, the race, obviously by the title, you've probably figured out that I will be covering. And then the Holy Bull that Jack is also doing. Two really good fields. I'm in love with this Bob Lewis field. One of the strongest fields we've seen in recent years, in a race that, you know, is pretty productive in terms of the Derby. Kind of fell off in the last, you know, 2-3 years, but it's bouncing back. I would be very, very surprised to see, not see one of these, at least one horse from this field end up in the Kentucky Derby. It's a, you know, 10-4-1, 2-1 points race, so 10 points to the winner, 4 to second, so on and so forth, but still very high quality. And it's a 1/16 Grade 3. Let's waste no more time because we have a lot to get into. And start with the one, Medina Spirit, 1/2 in here for trainer Bob Baffert. Medina Spirit's coming off a really good second in the Sham Stakes. Ran Life is Good, who many consider to be Bob Baffert's best three-year-old this year. Ran to a 3/4 of a length, and he closed super well. He sat second most race, but was coming from about 4 lengths off the pace. He made up 3.25 lengths in the stretch very nicely. In his first start around 2 turns, and you can tell coming from that race, he's one that you had to look for going forward on the Derby trail. Now, I wouldn't be surprised to see Baffert scratch him, but I do also think if he's entering him, he's probably running him. But this is another horse you could probably head out to a place like Arkansas for the Southwest in a couple weeks should Baffert elect to scratch. But if he's to run, I think he has a good chance to run well in here because that was such a good effort last time out. He has the 2-turn experience. That was his first race without blinkers. So a lot of factors could have given him excuses had he ran poorly. He did not. He ran really well. And expect Medina Spirit to run pretty big this upcoming weekend. The 2 is Rombauer. Rombauer, only one win came on the turf on debut at Del Mar last summer. But he's been really good, really consistent in stakes company. In his last 2 starts on the dirt, both grade 1s, was second in the American Pharoah when he came from last to finish a really good second behind a Get Her Number, closing into a pretty pace that really didn't favor him. And then last time out, in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile, ran a sneaky good race, in my opinion. This is a horse who had to come from way back at a track that wasn't really doing closers many favors, and he finished really strongly. You know, 5th, you can't really see much of it because he was beaten pretty well by the top 2 or 3, but nevertheless, made up a ton of ground in the stretch, and that was really encouraging for me. My biggest worry with Rombauer, and the reason I am looking against him in this race, is because he's coming off that slight layoff from the Breeders' Cup. It's been a couple months. He's probably going to need the race, and you know the pace doesn't really do him any wonders. And you know, while he's a good closer, he can really close into any setup. I feel like he is one that's slightly dependent on a quick pace, and for that reason, it is a little hard to 100% rely on him to be a win contender, but I do think he's one that could fill out an exacta or a trifecta. The 3 is Parnelli. Parnelli, only one win in 5 starts. This horse is a personal favorite of mine, and he's been fairly good. Last time out in the Sham was 3rd, beaten 13 lengths, but, you know, he didn't have the greatest go-around. You know, he got bumped around at the start a little bit, got really far back early on, which is not his forte, but Life was Good. Just basically out-sprinted everybody and kind of made it his own race, and that took Parnelli out of his element. But you go to his races before that, took him 3 starts to break his maiden, but he broke his maiden by 6 lengths, beat a nice horse of Doug O'Neill's named the Great One, who's come back to do some nice things. And before that, he was 2nd by a neck behind 2 horses, Spielberg and Hot Rod Charlie. Well, Hot Rod Charlie ran 2nd in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile. He's also in this race. Spielberg won the Low South Futurity in his last start, and he's also in this race. So he's never lost to bad horses, and you know, he ran both of those horses to a neck. And those 2 horses, who we'll obviously get to in a moment, will probably be number 1 and number 2 in the betting. So certainly no shame in that. Obviously, that last race showed regression in all forms, on speed figures, visually, so on and so forth. But I think he's one that could bounce back from that. He's going to have to be up in the game early on, but it's not like there is Life is Good that's going to out-sprint everybody to the lead and just keep going and going and going. That type doesn't exist in this race. So he's got a much better chance this time around. However, I don't know if he has the talent to win. I need to see him bounce back from that effort last time out before I can rely on him, and again, in a race. So I have to pick against him this time around, but I am also expecting a decent run from him, much more improved than that sham. The four is Hot Rod Charlie, who very nearly pulled off a monumental upset in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile last time out, went second, beaten less than a length by Essential Quality, who will be the champion two-year-old that went announced Thursday night, so this will probably be out by then, and if not, well, then you already know Essential Quality is the two-year-old champ, but he ran huge. He closed, into that race. That was a new element he showed in only his second, start around two turns on the dirt, coming out of a maiden win at Santa Anita. You know, there were so many reasons he did not need to run a big race, but he still did. Like I said, he'd been running on the grass before that too. And this is another horse. Like I was saying with Parnelli, this horse has never really lost a bad horse. His two losses on the grass were to Get Her Number and Tarantino, who are both, Tarantino's a nose away from being a stakes winner on the grass. Get Her Number is a grade one winner. So he had really good form then, that beat Parnelli, who, like I said, has done some good things. And then obviously, not much more needs to be said after that good second in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile. Big question is now, how is he going to bounce back? Because he, like Rombauer, has had some time between races. We don't really know because we've never seen him off the layout before. Doug O'Neill wins at about the same rate with horses coming off of, this amount of time in between races as he does on a regular basis. So O'Neill's not particularly bad, but he's also not the most high percentage trainer, only 13% in the last 2 years. So there are some concerns for me in that regard, but I think on pure talent, he is the best horse in this race, but he does have some mitigating factors that do make me cautious to put him on top here. I think he'll run fine, but he is certainly going to need this race, in my opinion. The five is Roman Centurion. This horse, in my opinion, had the second most impressive last start, coming out of a maiden win at Santa Anita. It was his first start going two turns. He closed from last in a 10-horse field, or second to last in a 10-horse field, I should say. Had to weave his way through traffic, but when he got through, man, did he take off and then some. And his first start was totally excusable. You look at this horse, he's big, he's rangy, he's by Empire Maker, with, some more classic distance on the dam side. So, of course, he's going to need two turns. Well, he debuted sprinting. Behind Life Is Good. So he was never winning that race anyways. It didn't help. It was six and a half furlongs. Then he got out to two turns and he flourished, improved massively on the numbers, on the speed figures. And it was a great ride by Juan Hernandez. Is he going to, improve off that effort? He has to, of course, to compete with this level. But does he have any pace to close into? He didn't really in his last start, but we're talking about a very tough Derby prep, probably one of the best we'll see all year, off of a maiden win, but, beating some horses that I don't really find them as any future graded stakes winners on the dirt in that field. So that is my concern with this horse. I feel like he's one that could, grind away late, but I don't think he's one that you can reasonably expect to hit the board based off that last performance. He has to prove me wrong, in my opinion, in this race. I think he has talent, but I don't like the circumstances, and I just think he's going to be overmatched by a couple of the top horses in this spot. Six is Wasprint. You can be confident Wasprint will be the longest shot on the board, despite having, frankly, the nicest pedigree and some nice races under his belt. Really, his maiden race, the only nice race, I should say. He's won one race. That was his maiden win at Del Mar, going two turns, and then he's been fourth in the others. And he's been beaten 29 lengths, in his last two starts in graded stakes company. And his only other loss was another 13 lengths on it. That's 42 combined lengths. I don't think he's a bad horse. I do want to preface that. His running lines don't do justice to how good he is because his maiden win was very impressive. But his last two runs in graded stakes company, while obviously he's had some circumstances that didn't do him well, at the end of the day, they just weren't impressive. He had every chance in the world, in my opinion, to close into that pace in the sham, and he just didn't. And, it was obvious that Medina Spirit and Life Is Good were better. Medina Spirit was, a good, 18, 19 lengths in front of him. Parnelli was still quite a ways in front of him, by probably 6 to 8 lengths. So he's been overmatched by two horses in this race already, not to mention he's lost to Spielberg on multiple occasions. He's lost to Rombauer once. His maiden win, the field from that race, has never, not come back to do much. So, there's case after case that this horse is probably overmatched at this level. However, like I said, he does have the best pedigree. His dam did win the Breeders' Cup Ladies Classic back in 2009. The seven is Wipe the Slate. This horse is very intriguing to me. Coming off a nice maiden win, going 7 furlongs at Santa Anita on opening day, December 26th. This was an impressive win. He's had a really nice stalking trip. He pounced when asked by Mario Gutierrez and just drew off with ease by 3 1/4 lengths. That was on his second start, his first start. He also ran into Life is Good, finished in front of Roman Centurion by a ways. But, you know, losing in a sprint race, I don't think anybody could beat Life is Good sprinting. No three-year-old, at least, could beat Life is Good sprinting in any circumstance. So if we're wiped the slate to lose to win, especially on debut, where we know Doug O'Neill is certainly not going to excel, that there's no shame in that. So for him to come back how he did in start number two, first start with blinkers, getting a little bit more distance, was really impressive to me. Now he gets out to two turns, and this is a son of Nyquist for, you know, so obviously the Reddams, you know, owned in Doug O'Neill trained and Mario Gutierrez rode Nyquist, but it also helps that Nyquist and Uncle Mo bloodlines in general really excel once they get out to two turns. Maybe not classic distances, but a mile and a 16th, a shortened two-turn mile. Those races are right up their alley. We've seen it time and time again. You go back to the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies from last fall, Vequist. When she got out to two turns, did she turn it on or what? I think Wipe the Slate's probably going to fall in the same boat. He's working phenomenally. You look at those times he's putting up visually, watching those works on XBTV. They've been great. And, you know, Mario Gutierrez isn't riding too bad, in my opinion. From what I've seen this meet and towards the end of 2020, I've been pretty impressed. He's certainly, I think, in my opinion, he's kind of rejuvenated his career over the past 6 to 8 months because he's been riding a lot better than he had been in the past, and he's been doing it with a lot of different horses, turf, dirt, long, short. He's done it all. So for that reason, I think there's a lot of big factors that do wipe the slate a lot of favors. And the final horse in the field is Spielberg, the winner of the Low South Futurity. It's been a weird ride with this horse. Six starts for a two-year-old in general nowadays is pretty impressive. But for Bob Baffert to do it too, kind of insane. Shows this horse has some very strong constitution. No layoff lines. He's not coming off a layoff into this race. Just very, very impressive horse, in my opinion, from that standpoint. I don't think he's the best racehorse, especially in this field. Obviously, it took him three starts to break his mane. He was a runner-up in Del Mar Futurity, third in the American Pharoah, where, you know, there weren't really any better horses behind him, so he kind of defaulted to those positions. Then he beat Parnelli by a neck, flopped into Bob Hope. Bob Baffert admitted he shouldn't have ran him there. And then he comes back and wins the Low South Futurity. That was a huge effort. I can't deny that. At first glance, I didn't love it because he didn't beat much. At first glance, now the runner-up, the Great One, came back to break his maiden by 14 lengths. He ran a 101 according to Brisnet figures, pretty similar on Bayer and Equibase figures. So obviously, and that was an 10-11 point improvement from his two other highest figures. So obviously that last race was a career race. I just am very skeptical he can replicate it because he still has to take that step up. The Great One's a good horse. We saw that with his maiden win. He's going to have something to say on this year's Derby Trail. But, you know, you look at it, I feel like Wipe the Slate has more upside going into this. I think that horses like Hot Rod Charlie and Ron Bauer and Medina Spirit all have more talent than him at this stage in their careers. And, you know, then you have horses like Parnelli and Roman Centurion, who I think are still waiting in the wings to possibly be better. I'm not saying, you know, Spielberg's going to finish behind all those horses. He's a grinder. He likes to fight most of the time, other than the Bob Hope. But I also am emphasizing there are six horses, in my opinion, in this race who I think have more upside and talent than him at the end of the day. And for that reason, I do just want to go against him, especially knowing he's probably going to be favored. I just do not see any value or logic in picking him in this spot. He might be able to sit the best trip, but I still don't think he can act on that on talent. Could be wrong, but I don't think so. My pick for this race, I feel like it's kind of evident based on all the positives I went into with Wipe the Slate, and that's why he's my pick. And I'm going to give negatives because I gave positives and negatives to every horse. I know I didn't give too many when I talked about it, but it's his first start around two turns, and I know I use that as a positive, but, you know, plenty of people could view that as a negative, and he does have a little bit more sprinter to his pedigree on the dam side. That's certainly concerning, and he is pretty quick, it seems like. He does like to show quite a bit of early speed, so he might just be a sprinter, but at the end of the day, I feel like I can project based off that maiden win, two turns will be in his wheelhouse. I know other people are going to look at it differently, but I'm not going to. I think that he has the talent to win this race, plus I think he's going to get a really nice trip sitting right on the front. He could be first because there truly is no confirmed speed presence in this race. So Wipe the Slate on top for me. If I was going to use some horses underneath, it would be Parnelli and Ron Bauer. And really, I only use those two because I like them more than everybody else. But listen, Hot Rod Charlie's not bad. Medina Spirit's not bad. Roman Centurion's not bad. And heck, you know, Spielberg's consistent enough where he could hit the board. It truly is a wide open race. I can confidently say I have a top pick in here, But, you know, I really would never play this race in you know, an exotic setting in terms of, you know, exactas and trifectas, so on and so forth, because it's just way too hard. You know, I'd have to, you know, be using all these horses in those positions. I do have a confident pick in the win spot, though. That is like the slate, but you can really choose any horse in this race, and I would have no negative feelings towards that, because there are plenty of talented racehorses in this year's Bob Lewis. Please enjoy it at the end of the day. This is going to be a heck of a Derby prep. We're going to see at least one or two of these horses on the first Saturday in May in the Kentucky Derby starting gate. And really, this is the beginning. From here on out, it is Derby, Derby, Derby here at the Racing Rundown and in the racing industry. For Eric DeCoster, I'll see you all next time.